right, good evening everyone and welcome. Thank you all for coming out tonight. My name is Chad Simmons. I'm with Building Bright Futures. We're a statewide organization that focuses on all things early childhood. We are advocates and supporters of improving the system of our youngest Vermonters. So that is what we do. I'm the coordinator of the local council for Southeast Vermont Building Bright Futures. So I encourage you to talk to me afterwards and learn a little bit more about. We meet monthly here in Brattleboro. And we're always looking for input and stories and ideas on how we can improve our early childhood system here in Southeast Vermont. So tonight we have a fantastic event. I'm very excited about what we've been able to do with our partners, Let's Grow Kids, the organizers of tonight's event. And the intention behind these events is to ignite a conversation about how are we raising our kids in the state and across the country, and where can we improve? What can we do better? So we hope that tonight will be the start of a conversation, an ongoing conversation about how we can fully and aggressively fund and support our children from day one, if not before. So as we move through the evening, I encourage each and every one of you to think of this one question. What would our communities, our towns, our state, and our nation look like if we fully and aggressively supported our children? Just think of that and envision that and have that question going on while you're watching tonight's documentary film and during our panel discussion. So before we get going and introduce our moderator for the evening, I just want to thank everyone that helped make tonight happen. Of course, Let's Grow Kids, they're the primary organizers along with 16 other statewide organizations. The Latches Theater for helping us make this an amazing event and donating some of the food for tonight. BCTV, which is filming tonight's event so that those that couldn't make it tonight will be able to watch. I also want to recognize some of the volunteers that were behind the scenes that were able to get all the materials together and is going to help clean up and prep. And finally, those involved in recruiting of the panel. Now, as you see, our panel, really excited about our panel tonight, and they're all very busy people. So I want to both thank the panel as well as thank those who helped support getting the panelists here tonight. It's truly amazing to have such great support. So with that, I'd like to introduce tonight's moderator for the event. Chloe Leary has served as the executive director of Winston Proudy Center for Development, for Child Development since July of 2007, and was a Proudy parent for 5 years prior to that. She graduated from Boston University with a dual degree in MBA and MPH with a focus on healthcare management. After 2 years working at the Brattleboro as a data analyst, she became director of operations at Monagnac Developmental Services in Keene, New Hampshire. She is dedicated to creating communities where everyone is valued and has a chance to develop and contribute their gifts. So please welcome Chloe Leary.
Thanks, Chad. And thank you all for coming. This is so exciting. The turnout is even better than I expected. So I'm really excited that our Building Bright Futures Council could help Let's Go Kids host this event in our community. We are going to see a really powerful, part of a powerful new documentary PBS is putting out in the spring of 2015. So the Raising of America helps explore how we can support kids to have a strong start, which will contribute to their future success, and to creating healthier communities and a prosperous, more prosperous society. So it's really a big picture. Like, it's not just kids are cute, this is our world and our future. So I'm really, I think this is an exciting time in Vermont. We have a lot going on in early childhood, and understanding sort of the context of why it's important is critical if we're gonna make a difference and sort of have the vision that Chad mentioned. So thank you for coming and being part of the conversation, because it is a conversation and a dialogue. So tonight we are, going to set the context with, we are fortunate to have Dr. Valerie Rooney here to give you a crash course in brain development. You've brought your pens and pencils, but she will help us understand the importance of this time of life of early childhood development. She has a presentation that will set the tone for us then to watch about 27 minutes, actually, of the work in progress. It's a documentary. After that, we'll have a chance to hear from our panelists for a few minutes each about their perspective and their take on why early childhood is important. And then the most exciting part, I think, of the evening is we get to pull it all together and talk with each other about what's happening in our community, what we can do, and why this is important. So that's what the next hour and 45 minutes-ish look like. It's, you know, again, thank you for being here. So I'm really happy to introduce Dr. Valerie Rooney. Valerie has been a pediatrician in Vermont for 24 years in Bellows Falls and Brattleboro. I'm sure many of you know her. She went to medical school in New Jersey and then did a pediatric residency in Boston before coming here and making her home here. She's very active in the field. So currently serves on the executive board of the Vermont chapter of the American Academy of Pediatrics. She also is a consultant for Blue Cross Blue Shield and for the Vermont Department of Health and adjunct faculty at UVM Medical School and Dartmouth Medical School. So very busy, as Chad said, and really, really appreciate her coming to talk with us. And please join me in giving her a warm welcome here tonight. Thank you.
So I've been asked to talk to you about the neuroscience behind what happens when children's brains are developing and how that affects how they learn and how they function as adults for years to come. So this is a presentation that Dr. Jody Brakely actually put together. She's a developmental pediatrician. I am knowledgeable but not expert, just so we're all clear. So I'm going to try to take you through this. And then I had some additional things I wanted to show you from a presentation that I went to this past weekend by Wendy Davis, who's a pediatrician who used to be the Commissioner of Health. You probably know her in that role. And she was talking about adverse childhood events and had some data for Vermont. And I thought you might be interested to see that and see what the long-term impacts of really bad things happening to little kids is, but also talk about the strength-based approach a little as well. So we'll see if I can work this thing. Do you need the microphone? Do I need the microphone? Okay. This is the slide from Let's Grow Kids, who I've just been learning about myself, actually, and introducing you to the first years and a little bit about, as well as, as well as Jody Brakely, who's a wonderful pediatrician up in Burlington and was at Middlebury, who developed these slides. And I think the point that a lot of people wanted to be sure that everybody understood is that although the majority of brain development does occur in the first 3 years, that there are still changes happening throughout your life, and just because something bad happened when you're young doesn't mean you cannot rework the pathways that are developing as you get older as well. So this is just a little fun factoid, although I thought you were fixing the Google thing. Somebody told me they were fixing, it's not called Google, it's called something else. Anybody know what it is, a Google?
Lots of Google.
So either way, you can see that there are zillions of brain cell connections. And I think that was what they wanted to show you. And those brain cell connections are called synapses, because, of course, in the medical world, we can't call anything just something basic. We have to have another word for it. But their point was supposed to be that early development and simple connections get formed first, and then it gets more complex as you develop. And that the stronger the connections are, in the one layer, the stronger they are as they go, as the cells develop further. So also, that pruning occurs, so you don't use all of the brain cells you start out with, and so certain pathways that are used a lot get reinforced and other ones are eliminated. So stress has both good and bad effects on the brain. And so there are a couple of examples here of stress that actually people actually develop and learn from, as well as stress that becomes so toxic that one cannot really bounce back from it, and it becomes a pattern that you use over and over again. So can anybody think of an example of positive stress that somebody might have in their life? Off the top of their head for a kid.
Baby prevents from being born.
Yes, a new sibling. That's a classic one. Also, starting a new school, getting a new caretaker, those kind of things. But if you have somebody in your life who is helping you talk about through these things and adjust to these things, then it becomes an actual learning experience, and you internalize that and can start working through that. But in the beginning, it does cause a higher heart rate and a little bit of elevation in your stress hormone levels. But something more serious, still you can bounce back from if it's not ongoing all the time. And this would, an example, this might be a death in a family. Even moving turns out to be a pretty big stressor, as anybody who's ever had to move suddenly could probably tell you. But the ones that are more worrisome are the toxic stresses, where somebody, and we can all think of children who are living in these environments that are constantly chaotic. You don't know who's going to be yelling next. You don't know who's going to be throwing things next. You don't know who's going to be hitting next. And so when you're in that constant state of arousal, that's what is considered a toxic level of stress. And so here's a picture of CAT scans of both a normal three-year-old and a neglected three-year-old. And if I had to guess where this child came from, I wasn't provided with the actual original. You can notice they got it from the Sydney Morning Herald. But so I don't know where the original picture came from, but if I had to guess, I would guess it came from an orphanage. Where those children are left in cribs in some other countries, you know, for the first couple of years of their life and get very little response. And so the brain actually literally doesn't grow and doesn't develop, and you can all see the difference. So I don't know that you want me to go through every last little bit about this, but the one point that they make is that a child doesn't learn to regulate their emotions well when they're living in this constant level of stress. They become reactive over and over and over again, and then we all see what happens to those kids when they're older. So, here are the things that you need to have your brain develop in a healthy way. You need nurturing relationships, right, with people who actually respond to you. I don't know, how many people have been on the website for this organization? Anybody yet? One of the things I didn't think to ask them to download, but would have been really helpful today, but I suggest going to look at it online, is there's just a video of a baby sitting in front of the mother. Have you all seen this, where the baby reacts to the mother and then the mother stops reacting back to the baby?
It's in the video.
Excellent. So that feedback, a safe, healthy environment with no lead paint, no toxic fumes, no mold, all of that kind of stuff is necessary, and then interactions with other adult caretakers, as well as good nutrition. So in terms of relationships, it's very clear that you need a relationship with a consistent and interactive adult. And I think that's the important take-home message. I've all seen some of those moms who are either kind of a little strung out or are super depressed and who aren't reacting back to the baby. And so they're not getting that interaction over and over and over again, teaching them about give and take. And so they need that back and forth interaction, sometimes called serve and return. So again, making the point that a safe, stable environment helps the most for both learning and for learning to regulate your emotions. And here are some good examples that everybody in this audience, I'm sure, knows is how good for little kids' brains. All you have to do is watch them when they're singing, or you're reading to them, playing with them, and talking to them. In terms of nutrition, obviously, we all hope that everybody starts out their life with some being breastfed. That doesn't work for everybody, and there are good fallbacks. So it's not as if you didn't breastfeed a child that they're doomed, but we do know it's good for their brain. But they also need sensitive and responsive feeding support. So in other words, the mom can't be talking on the phone, shoving the bottle in the baby's mouth while the baby's sitting in the stroller, that they really have to be holding, talking, cooing, looking, smiling, and reacting all the time. But especially the first couple of months and years, nutrition is especially important, including iron intake. And that's the one thing we sometimes find that parents struggle with a little bit. They're given a lot of milk sometimes, and sometimes less in the way of high iron foods. And interestingly, just as an FYI, all cereal in this country, box cereal, is actually iron fortified. So as long as kids are eating cereal once a day, usually they're getting a pretty good intake of iron.
But if everybody's seen those kids who are just constantly having a cup of milk or a bottle of milk with them, and so when they're drinking milk, they're not getting all the other micronutrients that they need, and they're filling up on milk and getting calories, but not all the nutrition that needs are being met. So everybody to get to their full potential. What did that do?
So I'm going to skip the next slideshow. I'll start
with
the next slides. Yep.
Thank you. I thought there were more slides the other day. So that's the stuff that Jody Brakely put together for us. Oops. So I'm not going to take you through her whole 45-minute presentation. I'm going to skip ahead a little bit, if that's okay with you. But I did want to just talk. How many people have heard that expression, adverse childhood experiences? So almost everybody in the audience. So I just want to go through what the actual definition is for the people who haven't heard it, or to refresh the minds of people who have heard it a while ago. So it's children who have experienced either verbal abuse, physical abuse, sexual abuse, or family dysfunction that results in one of these other listed occurrences happening. And there is some good data that shows that these early experiences actually turn on genes or turn off genes. And so they actually regulate whatever you're born with. You might be born with a certain tendency to be anxious or a tendency to be sad. But adverse childhood events can make you much more likely to go down that pathway than you would be otherwise, turning on parts of your genes and turning off others. So I'm going to skip through the science of this. Is there anybody who really wants to see the total science behind this, or do you want to kind of see the Vermont data?
Vermont data.
So again, they're showing you. So there's some overlap between these slides and the and the slide that I just showed you. But this is a good example of where a toxic stress causes this chronic fight or flight reaction, and where you're actually surging. So, you know, you might call it norepinephrine or cortisol, but we all think of it as adrenaline, essentially, where you're hyper-stimulated and you're over-aroused all the time. It changes your brain architecture. You can't settle yourself down, and then more toxic stress comes along, and this continues to be a problem. So, in Vermont, the national data. So this all came from a study that was done in an HMO out in California and also with the CDC. And so they're looking at adults and asking them to reflect on what kind of adverse effects they had in their life. And one of the things that they were able to see was that the more you had of these adverse effects, look how much more likely you were to have more and more problems. So did you see the slide behind or something? So this is the one I wanted to kind of sort of start out highlighting a little bit. So here's for children who have developmental delays. Look at what happens as the number of risk factors they have increases and how much more likely they are to have serious identifiable developmental delays. I thought that was the most impressive thing that of all the slides she showed us. This conversation came up apparently in the legislature this year. How many people knew that came up in the legislature this year? Anybody? Because I pay a lot of attention and I didn't know. It turns out it was introduced by an obstetrician who was frustrated by the moms in his practice not getting the services that he thought they needed early on to provide information to them and parenting skills before the kids were ever born. And so this is going to get reintroduced this year. This is why I bring this up. Very important for people to be paying attention to this conversation this year. Talk to your legislators, please, if you think this is important. So here's what they learned in the overall ACE study, and here's what data the health department was able to accumulate and put together for Dr. Wendy Davis and Barb Frankowski, who put these slides together and built on them together with each other. So you can see that 42% of kids their cutoff was age 18 when they were trying to do this. So I don't know how big the sample was. I can't tell you about the actual study, but they had their epidemiologist put this together for them. And you can see on here that
14% of kids have four or more stressors. And that's a pretty big number of kids who are trying to overcome a lot of hurdles in their life. And I think the goal we have as pediatricians is to identify potential stressors early and refer for treatment before they're able to have an impact long-term on kids' brains. And I think we're so lucky in Vermont compared to a lot of other states. I know it can be better, and I want it to be better, but in Vermont, we have children's integrated services. As pediatricians, we can pick up the phone, make a phone call, and get somebody early mental health, or at least we could till 2 weeks ago. I don't know what happened.
That's long.
So in terms of specific adverse events, you can see they were actually able to break this down into some data. And if you compare Vermont to the U.S. overall, some things are higher, like look at the one with somebody with an alcohol or drug problem halfway mm-hmm. down there compared to nationally. And I think we could all say that we've all seen this escalate in the last 5 years. And so if we were going to pick something that was a major difference in here, that we were coming out a lot higher, that's probably the thing that I would say is the one thing we can have the most impact on. And then of children who have, this is just another way of looking at it, of children who have had adverse childhood events, you can see that a huge number of them, over half, had more than one. And this is comparing 2010 to 2011, but the data, she said, was collected slightly differently, so it's unclear how much significance that really has. And this, again, is comparing in adults in the 2 years, Vermont, compared to other states. You can see we're a little ahead. And by age groups specifically, you can see who's at, right now in our state at the highest risk. And so look at the 65 and above, though. Mm-hmm. I know. Anybody have any thoughts on what that might be about?
Economics.
Could be. Or they're all dead, the people who had the higher. I don't know. Nobody knows. Just say, like all the people at the high, yes, because they had earlier mortality. Unclear. And here's just by gender. And this is my self-report, remember. So, you know, how many people are in denial, unclear. And this is also some data by education. And you can see the less education that you got through, the more likely you were to have more bad things have happened. Now, nobody's saying this is cause and effect, mind you. What's the cause and what's the effect? And here is it also, I don't think anybody's surprised by this one, that people who've had a lot of adverse childhood events have a lower income in Vermont and elsewhere. And this one had more to do with chronic disease. So with people who have at least four adverse childhood experiences in both total Vermont and, so four or more, or just average Vermont. And you can see, in general, so the purple ones are the people who had a lot of bad things happen, that they're much higher, especially in depression and at least one or two chronic diseases. So one of the members of the Green Mountain Care Board happened to be at this presentation and was talking about how powerful it was and how important it was. And so the pediatricians in the group all said to him afterwards, so if it's so important, why aren't you talking more about children? So we're working on it from our end. Yeah. And then this is another table just showing, again, that if you have more adverse childhood events, you have more risk factors. So I think that's getting towards the end. Yes, so this is some of the things, this is the bill I was talking about that was introduced last year in the House originally and then rolled over into a Senate bill. And there's this discussion about should it be mandatory for physicians to incorporate screening for this into their practices. And I gotta tell you, as a physician, the idea of making laws for you'll ask these two questions and these three questions is very uncomfortable and not likely to keep up with science over time. So we're all for screening and we're all for referring. But first off, you have somebody to refer these people to if you screen them positive. And until we have more mental health services, if people have a 5 or 6 month wait, all the screening we do in the office isn't going to do anything. But do I think encouraging physicians, providing them with tools to do this, giving them feedback about how it's going would be helpful? Sure.
But I caution all of you, from our end, every time they pass a law about what we have to do in our office, it just really confuses things. It doesn't necessarily make things better. But the health department is at least supposed to report to the Green Mountain Care Board how to implement findings into medical practice. And I think that would be very helpful from our end. The health department is a huge support to physicians in the community. We so appreciate them over the years. And so this is going to be reintroduced this year. And a good example is parenting classes in the OB office, as I said. So are we out of time tonight?
Yep, I would say, do you have anything else to wrap up?
No, that's it.
Okay, great, good. Are there any burning, pressing questions that folks have for Dr. Rooney right now that you just can't quite wait to ask? She's going to be on the panel too, so. Okay, great.
Thank you so much.
Now we get to watch a movie. Get your popcorn. We are going to see some clips of the work in progress of the documentary. So again, this documentary is being put out by PBS in the spring of 2015. And what we are seeing are clips of what they're working on right now. So remember, this is not the final edit. The music, the narration, some of the graphics might be off. This is not your Hollywood movie. This is a sneak peek, literally, at what they're working at. So just keep that in mind as you watch.
In the richest nation in the world, our children's well-being, measured across multiple dimensions, ranks 26th out of 29 rich nations. Why that is and what we can do about it matters. To this child, to all of our children, and to the future of our society.
We talk a good game in this country about being family friendly. But in providing for the economic and social needs of families, we are woefully behind other countries.
Want to show Daddy a book?
In today's date, we all got to work. And there's, I can remember back in like my grandfather's days, you know, the men work, the lady, the woman stay home and take care of the house and, you know, family, thing like that. In today's day, it surely can't happen. Everybody got to go out and work and, you know what I'm saying, bring it in.
Very good. Yeah, you're going to show Daddy.
Yeah, he works a split shift.
Good.
So like 2 in the afternoon to 1, 2 in the morning.
Yeah.
I'm on nights this week. And so the next week, though, I'll be on days.
Americans now work more hours than every other rich nation, yet the middle class is shrinking. Social mobility is less than it was 50 years ago. And most damning, 1 in 4 of our children is born into poverty.
David, you know, tomorrow's a really hectic day. I have a training. I have to be there at 9 o'clock.
70% of our children are growing up in families headed by working parents.
I bring work home with me, and it's not required. It's just what I do so that I don't feel as overwhelmed.
Things just barely work out. Like feeling security. I don't know. I don't really know what that feels like to feel like, all right, we're good.
No, you silly girl.
I wake up in the morning and I'm on.
It's like, where's my other child?
And then I go to work and I'm on.
You have a good day, little one.
And then I come home and then I'm on until the kids go to sleep.
There's 4 different places that everyone needs to be in.
It's too much. I can't do it.
Our policies actually actively discourage parents from being able to take care of those kids well in their prenatal months, in their early years, and getting them ready for school.
Among the world's richest nations, the United States is the only country that fails to provide guaranteed paid maternal leave on the birth of a child.
It took 9 years to get unpaid leave. That's disgusting.
40% of all American mothers are working within 3 months of their baby's birth, some because they want to, most because they have to.
Our child care expenses now that we have a second child, it's way more than we spend on our mortgage.
Among rich nations, our child care ranks 16th in affordability. 22nd in quality.
I picked him up one day and I went to change him and his bum was bleeding. So we left there right at that point.
We rank 31st in availability of childcare.
So this is our wait list, and this is the wait list just for infants and toddlers.
If I'm not there, I'm entrusting someone else to keep her safe, to teach her, to help her grow in all areas, developmentally, spiritually,
Mama.
Because we can't do it alone, you know.
Once you imagine that every family stands on its own, you're really making it impossible to create a national vision of everyone doing well together. A lot of us buy into this idea that a parent is the one responsible for their child's development and their outcomes.
Go ahead, Lily. What are you thankful for?
My mommy and my daddy.
But let's just step back for a moment and just look at what exactly the reality is for a child. So you have a child who's an individual with their biology and their genetics and their personality characteristics. And they're nested in their family, their peers, their close social relationships. But that is nested within another level, which is your school, your community institutions, your neighborhood. And that level is nested within our culture, our laws, our policies, our social structures, our systems. As a society, where do we see the role of our policies? Isn't part of that role to help children to grow and develop?
The business community of the United States has always shaped the big policy priorities of the country, the big political priorities of the country. The lobbying power of the next generation is next to nil. And as a consequence, our society steadily and relentlessly underinvests in kids. We shouldn't be surprised if so many of our children arrive at kindergarten unready to begin school. And we shouldn't be surprised that so many of our kids can't graduate from high school.
In 1970, the United States was number one in the world in high school and college graduation rates. Today, we've fallen to 15th in college completion, 21st in high school graduation.
High school graduation rate, we know, is strongly related to things that occur long before high school.
Can you write your name?
My name starts with an A.
There's your A.
So reading in third grade, the reading level is a strong predictor of whether or not you're going to graduate from high school. Well, what predicts reading in third grade?
Mama!
Yes, we are.
What is it?
The number of words you know when you're between the ages of 2 and 3. Oh, so what predicts the number of words you know when you're 2 or 3 years old?
Are you happy?
So we can keep tracking back.
You ready to see the doctor?
Beginning from the moment of birth, 700 new synapses are being formed every single second in all parts of the brain that basically become the architecture and the foundation of who we are as people.
We knew that effect, but this, so they took away nesting material.
Exciting new neuroscience research makes it clear. Early experiences get under our baby's skin and can alter the wiring of their developing brains for better or for worse.
You can see these processes in mice, you can see these processes in monkeys, and in the human data too, in young kids.
Very few of us remember what we experienced when we were babies or toddlers, but the brain remembers, the body remembers.
At a biological level, how does something that happens to you so early in life stick with you, persist forever, for a lifetime?
Everything kind of starts from the bottom up. If we don't do it right early, it's harder later. We pay more for it later, and we don't get as good an outcome.
Thank you.
The evidence is in. When we increase the time, income, and resources for parents and caregivers of young children, we help build a solid foundation for lifelong development, better learning, earning, and physical and mental health.
Not just one study, there are actually four independent longitudinal studies on early ed, all getting very, very high annual rates of return. Most of these benefits are public benefits.
All right, so what other sounds does animals make?
The part of this argument that I like the most is the social equality aspect of it. What's socially fair is also economically efficient. So if you were a government or somebody asking, where should I put my money? In the stock market or in a young child? You'd say, in a young child. Because you're going to get a bigger payback in terms of earnings of the child, in terms of reduced crime, reduced incarceration, reduced litany of social problems.
Hi, get his money.
If you would ask, you know, what really matters for kids when they're very young? I mean, what do we all want for our children? We want them to be happy and healthy and thriving. We want them to be growing and learning and being all they can be. This is a core value that we all share. The problem is that we don't all share a commitment to that for everybody's kids.
Fox and Socks, our game is done, sir.
There's never been a societal problem or issue where we have had so much information and done so little with it. Between the neuroscience and the economic literature, and there's just this explosion of information that no one is disputing, but we're still not acting on it.
Okay, you want me to give you a hug? You need a hug right now?
We don't just have an achievement gap in this country, we have a policy gap.
We need to be investing in the early years.
So we are going to have our panelists come up to the front of the room, and each of them is going to take a couple minutes to talk about this topic and early childhood from their perspective, and sort of what informs their thinking and what maybe, you know, to the extent that it works into what you prepared, how this information in this film gets your thinking going.
Hi, my name is Paul Millman, and I am president of Chroma Technology in Bellows Falls. We're a manufacturing company, employee owned. And we've been there, we've been in business since 1991, we've been in Bellows Falls since 2003. A couple of observations that just occurred to me as in this room this evening. One is that early childhood education and childcare cannot be predominantly a women's issue. If you look around the room, it is predominantly a women's issue. I can say that because I'm here. Now, would I not be here if I was on the panel? Wasn't on the panel, I don't know. So that's the first thing. And the second thing, that watching the movie, and the doctor will have to comment on this more expertly than I, is we have a medical system, and we're promoting a medical system which doctors cannot do what Dr. Jarrett did, and spend that amount of time with a child or with a patient. Not just pediatricians, but adult doctors cannot spend that much time with their patients. And so there's a little bit of a fantasy world that is created by seeing that wonderful interaction between a child and his or her doctor. The thing that I know is that the jobs now, but especially the jobs that are being developed, demand skills and problem-solving ability and cognitive abilities that jobs in the 20th century didn't demand. And we still have a 20th century educational system ostensibly going to prepare our children for the jobs that are going to be created from now on. There's some kind of a contradiction there. My temptation, I took a bunch of notes from reading materials. The Vermont Business Roundtable, which I am a member, is where I began to be very conscious of early childhood education and school readiness. The roundtable is, for very wonderful reasons, very committed to promoting early childhood education in Vermont. It's not one of the organizations that you see up there, but it is allied with all of those organizations. Why its name is not there, I don't know. At any rate, about 5 years ago, the roundtable took this on, and I was blown over. And where I was blown away was when Dave Finney, who was at that time president of Champlain College, I can't remember the name of the other school in Burlington. No.
St. Mike?
No, the small, this.
Burlington College?
This is awful because it's going to be on TV.
That's okay.
Anyway. They'll kill me. Anyway, so they did a presentation, and in the presentation, he said that by the time a child enters kindergarten, some children have vocabularies that are twice as large as other children. And not only the vocabulary is twice as large, but the complexity of the words is twice as great. It is Champlain, sorry. Is twice as great as other children, and that disparity continues throughout a child's life, and the repercussions of that worse. The repercussions of that disparity later on in life equate with things like jail time, income levels, marriages breaking up. All of this before they're 5 years old. This is very profound to me. So, it seems to me that there are some very profound but very simple answers, responses to this. One is, don't let the gap emerge. You know, once the gap emerges, it's bad. Not letting the gap emerge is good. To do that, you have to have quality early childhood programs that allow kids who would be deficient in those words to not be deficient in those words. The law that was put into effect in Vermont allows for 10 hours of preschool education. That's not enough. Keep the gap from re-emerging. After school programs, I think, are particularly important. I have a nephew who is 10 years old and who, if he did not have an after school program, would play with his iPad and watch TV. Because he has an after school program, his writing is improving, he's reading books. So don't let the gap re-emerge, because the gap can re-emerge. Business needs a quality workforce. But maybe of more importance is that people need an equal opportunity for a quality life.
I think I already had my turn.
Did you have anything you want to add?
Just a couple of things. Actually, in Vermont, pediatricians have been pretty lucky. As a rule, I think the majority of the pediatricians I know have chosen to spend more time with their patients and make less money. I've never felt sorry.
Thank you all. Helpful to hear from a variety of perspectives. Sort of how we view this early childhood time and why it's important. So I'm going to open it up to the audience if there are thoughts or questions. Have the mic, and
You know, if there is anything in the mood first, anybody have a question about anything our panelists raised or anything in the movie that you'd like to bring up? It's kind of time for open dialogue right now, so don't be shy. You really have to talk into the microphone. Does anybody have a thought or a place to start, at least? We'll give you a minute to think. Mike.
I don't think I do. There was a little bit of a disconnect for me between the movie and the wonderful presentation to start. I didn't see those kids that you were talking about in the film. And I think those are the kids that are really presenting the problems. If you're in preschools or if you're in schools, the kids who are living in toxic stress. So I don't know if you have some feedback you can give to the people in the film, but those are the kids that I think we really need to focus on. And I think we've talked a lot about Vermont's kids have pretty good educational outcomes, except there's still that learning gap, and often it's a socioeconomic learning gap. The other piece I want to that I've been hearing from educators at every level is we need a better connection between mental health services and education, because to support the kids who are experiencing that.
Great, thank you. I think that's a really good observation. I don't know if we have a chance for feedback. It's a thumbs up from Chad, yep. So that's probably part of the sneak preview will help them. And we're seeing some families in Boston who have some resources who we didn't see necessarily the families who are living in toxic stress all the time. So that's a really great example. And that continuum of services and connecting services. So if you think about, Dr. Rooney mentioned children's integrated services. So the state of Vermont, I think, is trying really hard to figure out how to connect multiple services to make it seamless from a family's point of view. But that's children's integrated services is 0 to 6, right? Or prenatal to 6, because as somebody pointed out, it's got to start before you're born. So thinking about that continuum and how to help connect to create a continuum of supports is a really important point. And I think there are some initiatives in Vermont that we're trying to get there, but we have ways to go. So thank you. Other thoughts, observations? Yes, Jean.
I think if we're still on feedback to movie, that kindergarten readiness was referred to a lot. And it's a little unclear if we're having this movie, what that is, what it takes to be ready. And, then we can kind of identify where we need to work on things.
That's a great point. I don't know if everybody heard, but kindergarten readiness is a big phrase that people use a lot. And actually, even in Vermont, we're talking about 38% of our kids are not ready for kindergarten. What does that mean? Liz, do you want to mention the kindergarten readiness survey a little bit?
Each year, kindergarten teachers are surveyed in the fall about their incoming class. And they are asked to rate their students according to some widely accepted measures of kindergarten readiness, language development and cognitive development and social-emotional development.
Self-help
skills, and kindergarten teacher.
Do caregiver, being able to separate from caregivers, it's a long survey.
And also some measures of do we think this child's learning is affected by hunger, illness,
sleep,
and fatigue.
Yeah.
So we've been collecting that data for, I think, maybe 15 years, 10 or 15 years. And it's not perfect and it's not fully scientific, but I think if you talk to kindergarten teachers, they may tell you certain things are more important than others. And most of the kindergarten teachers I talk to value kids' social-emotional development most strongly, stronger than any of the other things that I mentioned before, and that they will say, we can, our job is to teach kids how to read and how to do math and how to do the academic things, and what we really need in order to do that job well is kids who have good social-emotional development, good social skills, kids who can work in a group and separate from caregivers and pay attention for 10 to 15 minutes on, you know, on a teacher-led activity. And I happen to think those are really important things for our kids to be experiencing before they get to kindergarten. And I, you know, that's what we're all about.
I think, you know, Janice pointed out the there are pressures on the school system around letters and numbers and what you need to do, and really the work of young children, that social, emotional, executive function development. And Paul, I think you're talking about what kind of skills we need. I think we're starting to learn the importance of those skills to even learn to read and write and be available to learning. So. You're a kindergarten teacher.
Yeah. I can't help it.
I'm a kindergarten teacher who just filled out a pilot survey of the kindergarten readiness, and I've been doing this for a long time too. And what I'm seeing is that the family structures are breaking down, and I work in a sort of an idyllic school where I'm given the freedom to do what I think is developmentally appropriate for kids, which is not the case, I think, for a lot of kindergartens in Vermont and across the country, where the pressures for this academic achievement is so far beyond what I think children should be doing at this age, and losing that sense of being able to play, to being outside, to getting exercise. And so the contrast of kids coming in, and my group this year is unusually challenged by, it looked like the baby that was not getting the response from the parent. I can tell you exactly what that looks like with a five-year-old, because I see it every day in more than one child. And those kids are not able to access letters and numbers when they're so stressed. So my concern with all of this is how we can support families is the first thing. If parents are stressed, their children are stressed. And if we're trying to prepare them for jobs for 21st and 22nd century, when their brains are not ready for learning, how can we go forward as a community? And that's the part that scares me. I want some answers.
Yeah, thanks. So, thank you for offering that. Sort of, you can't be in early childhood and just like kids. You have to actually be good at working with adults and families. So, I don't know if people have thoughts about that. But you know, how do adults learn? How do you help an adult who didn't have parenting learn to be a parent? Because that's what you kind of have to do, and that's some of the work. So I know some people in this room are doing is figuring out how to support that family structure.
Yeah, definitely. Oh.
Hi, my name is Deb Woodcuse. I was in the field for many years and very passionate about it. And I actually came here from Massachusetts and was in a center that there was a two-year waiting list to get in. When I came here to Vermont, I worked with heroin-addicted parents, homeless families that were living in shelters, moms who suffered from domestic abuse. And it was amazing. I got to take those amazing skills that I learned about early brain development, impulse and delayed gratification control, how to implement that into a classroom, using sensory integration to help kids who had serious problems with disorganization / executive functioning. And it's funny, because, you know, Vermont is so small, I see those kids now many years later, and they're doing well. They're compared to their siblings. But I still lament the fact that they are in homes where their parents are also, their parents suffer trauma. Their parents have not, you know, necessarily risen above or are not, don't have the same resiliency. And I'm just wondering if, you know, if I had my magic wand, I wish we would look at the whole family and how do we raise up this whole family together to become resilient. I wish I had, you know, been able to follow through, you know, with those families a little bit longer and grow and sustain the relationships with the parents, so I can maybe actually help them to become resilient as well. I'm just wondering if there's anything very innovative in the state where we're looking at this like as a whole family and how do we, you know, break the cycle. Thank you.
Does anybody want to speak to that necessarily? Yeah, go ahead. Did I
even ask? Sure. Oh, I don't think I need one.
Okay.
I'm pretty loud. I think that it's, this has been rattling around in my brain while I've been here, and it's where we break into the cycle. And I don't know how we decide that. If it's before a child is born, if it's when a child is born, if it's providing more treatment and rehab programs for the parent, if it's making sure that we have income so that both parents don't have to work both times. I don't think there's a magic answer, and I don't know that. So what we try to do, I think, is break in a little bit here, a little bit here, a little bit here, a little bit here, and hope that it gets us where we want to go, but there's never enough of the breaking in at any point to really make the difference. And you know, we need to provide housing, we need to provide mental health services, drug and addiction programs, more income for people. I just was thinking, sitting here making all these notes of what we have to do. And one of the things that I found very interesting was when one of the men was talking in the film, he said, and we ought to be able to appeal to everybody on this, because he said, we need to invest in children in order to make the United States competitive in the future. And I'm thinking, why don't we invest in children to make their lives better instead of competitive? I mean, but there's a reason to invest in children for everybody here, but I'm not sure how we break in and how we, where, I don't know, if you've got, if anybody has that answer, Mike may have an answer, because he raised his hand. It's very confusing about how, where you put your emphasis and when you put it there. We could put all our emphasis on prenatal and birth, and then what happens to those parents, and what happens to the housing program. Anyway, I'm sorry.
No, that's one. I think the statistic that really keeps jumping out at me from Let's Grow Kids is this: 80% of the brain developed by age 3, 90% by age 5. Like, clearly, somewhere in that prenatal to 5 is a critical window. Not that it's all over. There's no doom and gloom. Like, our brain keeps changing, but something, and I don't know exactly what amount of what housing, what resources, but clearly, families with young children investing.
Right, but where do you invest? You invest in the child, or you invest in mental health treatment for the parent? You invest
yes.
in getting them a house,
yes.
or getting
yes.
them yes. a decent living
right.
wage?
Yes. Yeah,
it's just investing in the child.
It is absolutely, thank you, it is absolutely 100% not about just investing in the child.
Right.
We can't separate children from their families.
Melissa,
nice
hands.
Yeah, no, I just wanted to respond
slightly, a little bit. No, many of us here in this area, early childhood educators, are doing a lot of training right now on how to strengthen families, how to recognize stressors that we're seeing from parents, because we know we can only have healthy and strong children if we have strong families. And so, yes, we are working that. I know it's from coming down from the state to really help with that.
Yeah.
Do you want the microphone?
I probably don't need it. I'm Cindy Twombly from the health department. And, you know, what strikes me is that there is no answer. You know, we have to have programs for families who are in crisis first. And that's when I think we get those red flags, and parents realize something isn't working in their lives, whatever it is, and it can be a multitude of facts. We need big safety nets for loads of people in lots of different ways. We have a family nurse partnership now, which is a new program working at first pregnancies for young moms, that they are willing to participate in learning and close relationships. There's a lot of role modeling, motivational interviewing and conversations with them. I think we as providers need to get better at even offering what we have presently, and we need to improve our programs so much on prevention. And I mean prevention, I'm in public health. This is near and dear to my heart and probably everybody else here. We know that smoking, whether or not a child would become a cigarette smoker, is probably decided by the age of 5. When you look at the surveys done at the high school level, the levels of depression these students have, these youth risk behaviors,
mean it's happening early on in that early prevention. The latest studies on obesity, we do a much better job preventing childhood obesity than turning it around when we already have that. We have to look at prevention, and I have to say more programs, and we have to be better at offering what we do have as well.
And just that, like, the Nurse Family Partnership is a great pilot, and it's luckily part of Children's Integrated Services, so it's not, if we break down these silos of here's my special program, here's my special program, and say, how can we all do this together, who's the best point, then I think we can maybe get to prevention, because we can't even get to prevention right now. It's crisis, 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 even for programs that are meant to be preventive, so that's a challenge.
Can I make a comment about the silos? We have, when we had testimony up in the State House from people when we were looking at the budget, we heard from some families who had as many as 7 case managers. That's ludicrous. We need to figure that out. We should not have a family with 7 case managers. It's duplication, it's a waste of money, and it certainly isn't getting them the best care. So that's a huge...
Primary provider. Micah, you had raised your hand previously. I don't want to miss you. You're ready. There's a hand over chat.
Yeah, a quick response and then a question for the panelist. One is, I think it's been echoed already, there isn't one response, or there isn't one answer. However, it's incumbent upon us, those of us that are in the room and the conversations that we'll have afterwards, to start figuring out what those answers are and to direct those answers to our legislators so we can create policy that's changing the system. And addressing some of the issues that have been brought up in the movie and during the panel discussion. So I think, I guess there's a call to action here that we, within the field, kind of figure out where we prioritize those steps and those actions, and we communicate that clearly to our legislators, which is a pitch on December 8th. Building Bright Futures is hosting a community and legislative forum to start having a conversation about what that would look like at the State House. My question is, and this was a call to action that came out in the film, is what can the business community do? What are some concrete, very specific things that the business community can do here in the state of Vermont to support family, to support the whole family, and to support kids?
I think that was
for you, Paul. It can be for Paul, but I'd actually be curious to hear what others on the panel have.
Let's start with Paul and the panel, and anybody actually.
I and Coma both believe that it starts with people having wages that allow them to make decisions for themselves. That, with due respect to our legislators, I think that the state has options and responsibilities and power, but many of the bad choices that you find yourself having to make would be obviated if people earned decent salaries. A person who earns a decent salary can decide to send their child to preschool for more than 10 hours a week. Doesn't have to wait for the state to make that decision for them. A person who earns a decent salary, which, by the way, is probably more than a livable wage, and has quality health care, doesn't have to wait for the state to make the decisions that are often onerous for those people. So I think, and I'm talking for my company now and not for all companies in Vermont, although I wish I could, I think that it really does start with having jobs that pay well and that recognize that people have a right to live comfortably and have a right to make adult decisions for themselves and their families.
Thank you.
Yeah. Well, I don't pretend to speak for what the business community should do, but it wasn't very long ago that I was a parent, a young parent with young kids, and I looked at the young couple with two young kids in the movie here and couldn't help but think about my own young adult children, and I was very lucky to work for organizations that allowed flex time, or flexible work hours. And I look at some of the families of children, young children that I work with now, who are really locked into horribly counterproductive work schedules to any kind of quality family life. And I just think how can we continue to do that sort of thing? So I think that, and I don't know if this is a business solution, but we need better family leave policies, and parents shouldn't have to be working second shift and third shift and have their children in overnight childcare. I mean, I don't know.
Other thoughts? Anybody else in the audience? Chad's question? I have one other thought. I am a new pediatrician in my office. Dr. Field retired this year. We were sad to see her go, but we love our new partner as well. But she has a toddler and a baby, and we don't have any on-site childcare. And so how do you get to be a professional person, even, and get your kids to daycare at some ridiculous hour and not be able to see them all day? And if we had more on-site daycare, I think that would be lovely. There would be tax breaks for companies that had on-site daycare. Maybe there already is, and I don't know it. But it sure would help her right now.
And one just little tag to that is allowing parents the flexibility to be able to leave work to do a parent conference. I did my first one at Burger King at 5 o'clock on a Friday afternoon because that was the only time I could meet a parent's needs. And also to get their kids to doctor's appointments, to dentist appointments, all of that takes away from their work time. And when you have two working parents, those things can be compromised just because nobody's available to do them.
I just pointed out that last year there was a bill introduced into the legislature that would have required very minimal paid sick and personal time, very minimal paid and sick and personal time, and it went nowhere.
Everyone's books, which is a small business. We have like two full-time and two part-time employees, but can we
put the microphones
is
much easier to hear.
Thank you.
At my bookstore, it's always been, I mean, I never called it flex time, but I started it when I had two young kids, and most of our employees have been parents, and we've always done that, and it's so easy, and it's so crazy that any place doesn't do it for employees that, kid is sick, you figure it out. Somebody's kid is sick, they don't have to, figure out a horrible choice for their child. They have to go to a parent-teacher conference. We figure it out. We've always done that, and it's something I would not want to have a business that didn't do that. But it is really pathetic. I mean, we're a small retail place, and we don't have a lot of paid, but we do give people a paid vacation week every year. And I mean, it's like you have to do that stuff to feel like you're doing anything like the right thing. And I understand that a lot of places feel like, oh, I can't, whatever. They claim they can't afford it, but it's just not that expensive to do these small things that make people's lives feel like they work for them. And none of it has cost $1 million or anything. It's stuff that I wish that other businesses felt was, it's humane, it's the right thing to do, and it definitely, our employees have been with us a really long time, and there's a reason for it.
Judith Reichsman, and I'm trying to figure out just how we become Norway. I don't know how many of you were at that wonderful, wonderful, at the museum a couple years ago when one of the government people from Norway explained how much leave they have for the parents and how much, I mean, it was just delicious. And so I'd like to believe that businesses could help, but I sort of feel like it's got to be the legislatures, and yet how can we ever get people in this country to think that that's not just being communist? I don't know. And I also have to say that we should be really grateful that we do have the supports we do have, because having lived in Mexico for 6 months, I just came back to this country thinking that we had it made, because the education system there, at least what I was exposed to, was just horrible. And so we're not as bad as we think, I guess.
Can Vermont be like a Norway?
Oh, yeah. Can Vermont be like a Norway is the question on the table. Here, I'm all secede from
the... Paternity leave.
I was interested in the person who said in the film, it's not a question of not having... It's not because, as a society, there's not enough money. It has to do with how we choose to use that money and how we distribute what there is.
Right, I think people get territorial about their funding, too. It's a little bit of a challenge. Once things are set, how do you shift resources? But there are a lot of resources.
Yeah, go ahead.
My last suggestion for businesses for the evening is the Breastfeeding Friendly Employer Project that the Health Department has. Greatest barrier for women going to continue breastfeeding beyond 6 months or a year is that they don't know what they're going to do when they return to work. So oftentimes they stop. State of Vermont, the Health Department has a program. We can come out and talk with employers, and they can offer women one, information when they go out on maternity leave that they can continue to breastfeed when they come back, that the employer will offer them a place other than a bathroom to pump their milk, and three, that they will give them flexible breaks. And actually, that's part of the Affordable Care Act, and it should be offered to every woman in the state of Vermont and the United States. And if anybody else would like to talk with me about it, I would love to talk with you. Just so Pediatrics signed on to it, our local school district has signed on to it, Wyndham Child Care, we have Winston Prouty, we have 45 local businesses in this community that have signed on, and we'd love to help more find ways to give those children that healthy start.
That's a very concrete thought. Thank you, Cindy. Chad.
Sure.
Oh, yeah, it's still there. A quick just a piece about the film, and it's been brought up a couple of times. There was a reason why this film was chosen as kind of to kickstart this conversation. And I think it's because of some of the comments that were raised within the film, essentially kind of calling for a change in how we look at how we value our spending decisions. And so I think that's a piece of, and there's a reason why Let's Grow Kids chose this film to put out before it was even finished, because some of the content and some of the calls to action are really important as we gear up for the legislative session in terms of the values that we bring to our decisions and our policies. I had a question for Shirley. Shirley, I'm wondering if you could just describe a couple of things that you've experienced and you've used to kind of combat the trauma that your children have faced in years past, and what are some of the experiences that you've had as an adoptive foster parent?
Our little guy has seen two child psychologists, one from school and one on the outside. Because of his PTSD, my husband and I aren't sure sometimes how to deal with him. So we need the one to help us know how to do what's best for our little guy. I think the kids also, DCF has gotten a pretty rough rap because of a couple situations that have happened in Vermont. Again, I don't think it's DCF. I've worked really close with ours and with Brattleboro's, and I think it's more like someone else said in legislation, we've got to stop thinking so much of the parents and getting them back where they need to be, and start thinking of these little kids that have been in foster care and gone from foster home to foster home for 2-3 years and have no permanency yet because we're still waiting for unification and still waiting for these parents to come back and be good parents. We need more DCF workers. We need more help with all these kids that are in the foster programs.
More great thoughts to their question.
Absolutely. There's a lot of questions here this evening, how to make things work better for children. And I have to just bring it back to the child again one more time. So many children are in childcare today, going to childcare tomorrow, and they need quality programs right now. And a lot of the questions we've been asking, you know, how do we answer these problems? How do we find answers to these problems? Those children can't wait. And so, you know, when we're looking at a quality care, you know, a big piece of a quality program is how do we make it affordable, especially when subsidy rates are pathetically low. You know, I don't mean to sound disrespectful to the legislators in the room, but the subsidy rates cannot cover a day for a child in a quality program, especially a program that's serving breakfast, lunch, 2 snacks a day, providing those types of activities, materials that are responsive to the learning needs, the social needs of the children. So I agree, we have lots of questions to answer here, how to help children in the future. And of course, my thing though is that the children are coming into my care tomorrow and I need those supports for them tomorrow.
We have a few more minutes to take some questions and comments.
I don't think I need my phone either. I'm sorry, I think everybody...
I was going to make sure everybody could hear.
Another nut to crack in all of this, which I'm just raising, not because I have an answer, but I've been working on thinking about for 25 years. The Worthy Wage Campaign in 1993 was working on the wages of child care providers. At that time, they were hoping to raise it to $10 an hour nationally in 1993. And if you remember the graphic up there, we're still underneath $10 an hour. So one of the at the time that I was studying this, indicator of high quality child care was teacher turnover rate. Highest indicator of teacher turnover rate is salary. Thank goodness, the legislature is working so well for all of us, making sure that everything they can do, they are doing. There's so many issues on so many burners at the same time, but there is a very systematic way to do it, and I think the early ed community should be patting itself on the back. We are in the news. The president talks about early ed. The governor talks about it all the time. You want changes? Make sure you're voting next week. Make sure you're out there, because all these things really do matter. And I think that we have a great momentum going. We've got bright future back and freshly funded. So anywhere that we can inform our legislators of what's important and what our experiences are is really great. Your voice matters. But I don't want to walk out of here without remembering how far we've come. So many more nuts to crack
but this is our time, and let's keep the good work going. And for those of you who are not making a livable salary as a child care provider, something that I always like to remind people is that child care is subsidized. It's subsidized by you and I who are working for less than a livable wage. It is subsidized. It's subsidized on the backs of us who do the job because we love it.
Thank you. And that's a great point, maybe a good sort of closure point in the sense of it is a really exciting time in early childhood, not just for early childhood education, but for all the issues that we have. A president who's talking about it. We have a governor who's talking about it. We have an early childhood framework and an action plan available on the website, available for Building Bright Futures. We have Building Bright Futures Back, which is an infrastructure that can help sort of mobilize and create opportunities like this for us to talk about this really, really important topic. So it is a good time. It's hard stuff. It's hard to watch in our work, seeing families and kids who are struggling. But there is hope, and I think we have made some good progress, and that I think is a good note to end on, a positive in terms of this discussion. So we have a few more minutes. Elaine from the Let's Grow Kids campaign is here to talk with us for a moment. I just want to mention, if you are an early educator and you would like a certificate of participation for your STARS, please see Elaine, who's back in the back, and she can give you that. So here is Elaine from Let's Grow Kids.
I just want to say on behalf of Let's Grow Kids how delighted we are to be able to have taken the lead on bringing this sneak peek to Vermont and working with so many other organizations to make it happen. This is happening in 10 communities across Vermont over the course of 10 days. And this is hopefully the beginning of one of many more conversations. And I have had the pleasure of now coming to two Raising of America events. This is my second one. And the first one I was at was in my backyard in Hartford. And it's interesting that the questions, the comments, the issues are all the same. So I feel really energized and excited by the conversation. And I just want to say, as a parting thing, Let's Grow Kids. What we're trying to do, for those of you who may not know, is we're a public education campaign that just launched this past April, and our goal is to increase awareness of the importance of the early years in a child's life. It's privately funded by three foundations. There's the Permanent Fund, A.D. Henderson Foundation, and the Turrell Fund, and it's a three-year campaign, and our goal really is to try to do what you saw in the movie. When that gentleman said, just imagine what would happen if we gave every child the opportunities they needed to reach their potential, this country would explode with creativity. I think that's what he said anyway. So the last thing I would like to ask you to do is, on when you came in, you received some materials from Let's Grow Kids. One of those was a pledge. If you have not already signed the pledge, I would ask that you please do so. The pledge is how we are asking people to support the campaign, and we hope that you'll consider doing so. Thanks again.
And you can do it online, right?
And you can do it online.
And tell everyone you know, right?
And you can share it on all sorts of social media.
Great, thank you, Elaine. Thank you, everybody, for coming. And just a reminder again, Building Bright Futures is our local place and forum for continuing this conversation. So if you're not on the email list, definitely get on it. And we'd love to see you at meetings and events like this. Thank you so much for coming. Thank you to our panelists.
Woo!
And have a good evening.